Hey everybody, it's Chris from Preparedmind 101. This is kind of a housekeeping video. Believe it or not, I gain about 1,000 subscribers every 4 to 5 days. So I constantly have an influx of new viewers coming in pretty much all the time. And I get a lot of frequently asked questions. And lately, the frequently asked questions have been coming a lot more frequently. So I figured it is time for a new updated FAQ video. And that way, when someone asks, I can just direct them to this video and there you go. Because I would say I answer these frequently asked questions at least 5 times a day. So here we go. Frequently asked question number 1. This is one of the more recent ones. What is this hoodie that I'm wearing? Been getting that a lot. I just recently did a video on it. This hoodie is a 100% wool Lester River Bushcraft Boreal shirt. They're not exactly inexpensive. They run about $250. But as far as these types of garments, this is probably one of the best ones that's out there. It's 100% virgin wool. It's extremely warm, great for the outdoors. So definitely, if you're interested in this thing, check out my review on it. Frequently asked question number 2. What is that stuff you use to wrap your Becker handles with? Man, I get that one all the time because I've been doing that since I started the channel back in January of 2012. The stuff that I use is a tennis racket grip made by Wilson. And I've seen a couple different titles for it. I've seen it called Ultra Wrap and Super Wrap. But generally where you find it is at Walmart in the sports section where they sell the tennis rackets. Costs about $250 and you get 3 rolls of it. One end is tapered and has an adhesive sticky pad. You want to cut about 1/3 of it off, wrap your Becker handles with it, and finish it off with the taper end. Works on all sorts of things. It's one of the best grip wraps that I've found. Frequently asked question number 3. What is the stuff you use to strip your knives with? They're talking about the black coating on a lot of different types of blades like Beckers and some of the new Schrades and stuff like that. What's the stuff I use to get that off? Well, it used to be Jasco. Jasco paint and epoxy stripper, which that still works. However, thinking responsibly about people using this stuff, Jasco is extremely caustic stuff. If you get that, you have to wear gloves, and if you're just wearing like nitrile gloves, you get that stuff on your gloves, you've got about 5 seconds before it's eating through your gloves. So obviously it's very effective at stripping knife coatings. What I'm using now is a product called Clean Strip paint and epoxy stripper in a spray can. Works just as good, just requires a little bit more dwell time, and it doesn't eat through your gloves like instantaneously like the Jasco does. Jasco's kind of like that scene in Alien when they're trying to cut the face hugger off the dude's face and they cut the knuckle and the blood squirts and starts eating through the floor. That's Jasco. That's where Jasco came from. LV-426, they harvested a bunch of those aliens and said, hey, this stuff would be great for stripping paint. And they put it in a can. So if you don't want to get alien blood all over you and burn a hole through your floor, skip the Jasco, go to the Clean Strip. It's safe. I've had Jasco, most people that do this a lot have had Jasco burn. Jasco burn isn't fun. That's why you gotta have white vinegar nearby and a lot of soap and water. Stick with the Clean Strip. Frequently asked question number 4, who does my logos? The guy that does my logos, his name's Michael Spangers, and he's with Hellcat Design Studio. And I'll put the links in the description box below. Dude is freaking amazing at coming up with stuff. I just give him some rough ideas on what I want, and he cranks it out, and it's always awesome. He just did a brand new one for me because I wanted a simplified version of my main logo for t-shirts and morale patches and that sort of stuff. And he just cranked one out and it's freaking amazing. But anyway, that is the guy that does my logos. The next frequently asked question I get is, who does my animations in my videos, because maybe somebody wants to start a YouTube channel of their own, or like, how did you do that? Wow, that's amazing. Not so much. Actually, it's pretty simple. All I did was I went on Fiverr.com, and I just combed through the different gigs that people offer where they can animate your logo into different kind of animated sequences, and I pay them $5 and they spit it out for me. Bing, bang, boom, done. It's nothing special. I don't have the technical expertise to crank out anything like that, so I just use Fiverr. I got lucky with that last one. That's the only one guy that I saw was doing that animation, and he was really hard to get a hold of, so hopefully no one else finds it. But that's how I do it. I don't know how to use any of those real fancy graphic design stuff. It's just, I make smarter people do it for me. Next frequently asked question I get all the time in all videos is, what is that thing hanging around your neck? Well, this is an e-cig, a vape pen, whatever you want to call it. Basically, this is I forget the actual brand of this one, but it's very similar to a Vision spinner. This is your battery. This controls how much power it's got, how much it's burning it. Kanger T3D tank. And I just use Alt Smoke vapor liquid here locally. But it's an e-cig, so. People ask all the time, what is it? Well, there you go. Asked question I get is, who is Jessica? Well, Jessica is kind of like the Matrix. I can't tell you about Jessica. You have to see her for yourself. Sudden wardrobe change alert. That is because I was processing the video and I'd already processed it, got it all done, and I realized I missed one of the biggest frequently asked questions and probably one of the most important ones to answer. And that is, why don't I review guns on my channel? Well, I have several reasons why I don't do gun videos. And there's been a couple here and there, but I generally leave that to my gun expert friends, like Steve at Survival Tactics, who knows more about guns than I will ever know. The first reason that I don't do gun videos is OPSEC. Operational security. It's nobody's business what I do or do not have. And I think it's silly to show the whole world exactly what you got. I laughed my ass off watching shows like Doomsday Preppers, where these people brag about their big stockpile of guns. I'm like, boy, that was smart. I prefer to keep people guessing. Maybe I do, maybe I don't. Maybe I have this, maybe I have that, maybe I don't have anything. Quickest way to find out is to break into my house at night. The other big reason, reason number two I don't do videos, is infighting. I've been told that I should do guns on my channel because it will increase my viewership by 30 to 40%. And that might be true. However, there are too many reasons why I don't want to do it. And one of them is infighting. You cannot talk about a gun, a type of gun, an application, without it turning into a huge flame war anywhere. I've seen the most simplest conversations or questions turn into these big crazy debates that I don't want to deal with. It's just nuts. Like, hey, I really like this 9mm. Then you get 50 people saying, 9mm sucks. You need to have this. You need to have a 45. You need to have this. Here, watch this video. Do this, blah, blah, blah. You're stupid. Too many variables with firearms. Don't want to deal with it. Third reason, unsolicited advice. One time in a video, I mentioned a certain gun that I was looking at getting for concealed carry. And oh my God, did that open up the floodgates of unsolicited advice. For a week, every inbox I had was stuffed with, that's a good idea, that's a bad idea, you should do this, you should do that. Let me send you this this link to this ballistics report. Let me send you a link to this video of this bank robbery where the cop shot the guy 3 times and he didn't go down. Let me show you this. Let me tell you what you should do. I hate that. When I want advice, I ask for advice. When I started shooting the bows, I asked for advice, and I appreciated the advice that I got. With guns, it doesn't matter. I see people that are what I would consider gun experts. People that I personally know what the hell they're talking about from their jobs and their experience and whatnot. People still give them advice. I can't imagine how frustrating that is to them. The last reason is a reasonable level of experience. I know how to fire a gun. What I might or might not have, I know how to hit the target. I have what I need as far as my personal preparedness plan, which is nobody's business but my own. However, I'm not a gun expert, and I personally feel it irresponsible for me to be trying to throw out an opinion or teach somebody something on YouTube when I don't have an experienced instructor level of knowledge in order to be doing that. So a lot of people want me to do it just to, my badge of manhood, or because I'm talking about preparedness, I'm not talking about guns. You got to look at it from our point of view. There are dozens of reasons why to do it or not to do it. And for me, having worked it all out on paper, the reasons for me not to do it are greater than the reasons for me to do it. Now, on occasion, I didn't get as many chances as I wanted to this past summer, but I had planned on doing some more content, but that will be with Steve Hack at Survival Tactics, who speaks an entirely different language. I will say this, I know jack squat about assault rifles, ARs, AKs, and when he starts talking to gun people, it's like someone is speaking Aramaic to me, and they're just like, compensator, suppressed property, and this, blah, 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 blah. That's what it sounds like to me. So, do you really want to get your gun advice from me? No. So that's why I don't do it. It's not because I have anything against guns or any kind of political stance. I think everybody should have a gun. I think everybody should know how to use a gun responsibly. But there's just a place for everything, and here, it's not my channel. You know, let me stick with the things that I know, not the things that I kind of know. So hopefully that answers that question. Another frequently asked question I get is, what is my experience? Who the hell am I to be having a YouTube channel and talking about survival stuff on YouTube? Am I an Army Ranger? Have I camped on the summit of Mount Everest and killed a hog with my bare hands? No, I'm just like all of you. That's why you've never seen me call myself a survival expert or anything like that. I'm an enthusiast just like everybody else. But just like everybody else, the longer that you do it, the more knowledge you gain over the people that are newer. So I share my viewpoints. My viewpoints are a lot different from what you normally see on channels and stuff like that, because I don't stick to any certain teacher. I don't stick to any certain system. I'm not a bushcrafter. I'm not a prepper. I'm not a stockpiler. I'm not this, I'm not that. I defy labels. I do a little bit of everything. If I had to think of one way to describe myself, it's I think of the problems ahead of time and have the tools necessary to defeat most common obstacles. My experience, what helps me the most with what I do, is I was in the United States Navy for 10 years. I joined in 1991, got out in December of 2000. My specialty in the Navy was a damage controlman, and I got as high as Petty Officer Second Class. I was taking the test for First Class E6 at the time that I got out. Damage controlmen are basically the emergency managers of the ship. A lot of people think of us as the firefighters, but we handle firefighting, flooding, chemical, biological, nuclear defense measures, structural damage to the ship, toxic gas, aircraft crash and salvage team, all that stuff. And I got to the top of every team that I was able to do. I was one of the few people at the time that was qualified as a ship's fire marshal, as a second class petty officer, and duty fire marshal, all that stuff. So duty fire marshal, if something happens on the ship, the only person that is basically above him in authority is the commanding officer, the command duty officer. But the fire marshal calls the shots. He's in charge of everything. That means the fire marshal has to be, or the locker leader, or whatever team leader is on a ship, they have to be able to mentally process a mass conflagration, take in information from all sorts of people that are reporting in what is going on, and direct multiple teams and tell them what to do. So that kind of experience, what that does for you when you do it long enough, is anytime something happens, any kind of emergency, even something like the kid starts screaming, the kid gets hurt, you know, and the wife's like, oh, what's going on? What happens to us that have done that kind of job is our brain speeds up, so it's like everything slows down. And we think better and more efficiently when we're under pressure and making decisions. And that kind of mental skill is extremely effective in problem solving under duress. So that is the one thing that really helps me in any of this sort of thing. Plus my natural knack for MacGyvering and just thinking outside the box, problem solving and all that. Saying that you're a survival, okay, you can be a wilderness survival expert, you can be this survival expert. I don't like the label expert. You're constantly learning. Everyone's constantly learning. Anyone that says they're an expert, it's an ego thing. So we're all into this get together. We're all learning from each other. This is just my channel. This is what I try to share my experiences and the things that I've learned along the way and my outside the box ideas. But I don't have a YouTube channel. They didn't screen me at YouTube. This says, okay, show me your Army Ranger military survival expert card. How's that applicable to most situations? It's not. Everybody can be what I do. You just got to sit down with a pen and paper, work the problems, think it out, and learn as much stuff as you can. I'm way far away from being an expert, but I'm always learning, and the things that I learn, I then share with everybody on YouTube. And I like the comments because that's where you learn a lot of stuff you never heard of before. You know, interaction, community. So that's my answer to that. Next frequently asked question I get is, what do I use to edit my movies, so on and so forth? What's the equipment that I use? And this is, I guess, mainly people that are thinking about doing it themselves. I started out with a Toshiba laptop and Windows Movie Maker, which is hell on earth. You can get by with that at first, but you don't know what you don't know. Eventually, if you want to go professional, I think the best way is with a Mac and iMovie and then Final Cut, which I'm upgrading to here shortly. Now, I say that tongue in cheek because computers are one of those things that you got teams of. You know, you got the Mac team and you got the Windows team. It's like, well, someone's always going to say, well, I got a laptop that's got this, this, and this, and it can do just as much as a Mac can. Fine. Use whatever you want. I don't care. I'm not telling you you have to use it. People ask me what I use, and I like the Mac interface, and my MacBook Pro just crushes video processing, spits them out in like 3 minutes. So that's what I use. And in addition to that, another frequently asked question is, what camera equipment do I use? Well, I'm going to be upgrading that here pretty soon too, but I would suggest anybody that's interested in doing YouTube videos, just starting out, the base model that you should go for, what I have is a Canon HD 400 Vixia, HDS, something like that. It was like the base model. It was like $299. But Canon's work They play nicely with Max. Important thing about Canons over most other brands is even the most base model generally has an external mic input, which you are going to need unless you want to be known as the wind noise guy, which I used to be. Sound makes a difference. You want to be able to plug in different types of microphones to your camera. And you can get by with that for a long, long time. I'm still going to be using this camera, but there are certain applications that I want to do better video. So my next one I'm looking at is about a $900 camera. And then the one I got my sights set on after that is about a $1,500 camera. But, you know, I'm not quite there yet. So that's the stuff that I use. The last few frequently asked questions that I get generally are just people asking me to recommend something for them, be it a knife, a flashlight, so on and so forth. What's the best this? What's the best that? What do you think? Well, I'm not going to say what is the best. I'm going to say what I like the best. And I think, me personally, you all know this, for a general purpose survival knife that can handle almost every task. If you want to do bushcraft stuff, you might have to do a couple modifications to it. But it's Jessica, the Becker BK7. It's a combat knife that serves extraordinarily well in survival knife applications. It's big enough to baton larger wood. It's agile enough to still serve in its designed role, which is a combat knife weapon. It feels great in the hand. It's got great balance. It has a lot of ability to be modified to the user's preference, the user's taste. I have four of them. Well, actually, I have three of them. I just gave one away in a Facebook contest. So yeah, I actually gave away Jessica too, with a Godspeed sheath. But that's generally where I start people out at. People say, okay, well, I'm on a stricter budget than that. What else can I get? On the strict budget, I would have to say, as far as knives go, the one I like for the money right now is the Schrade SCHF-36. That, with the 90 degree spine, you still got to strip it, but that is a very, very capable knife. It's not a huge, big, long knife, so you're not going to be able to baton large pieces of wood with it, but I would suggest pairing that with a good axe, hatchet, tomahawk, so on and so forth. And then I still think the best bushcraft knife for the money for people starting out just practicing is the Mora Bushcraft Black. I have two of those. That knife just freaking rocks. It's awesome for fine detail stuff, using the sharp 90 degree spine. There's not much better than that. So that's generally the three starting point knives which I've been recommending to people now. For a larger knife, it's going to be the BK9, hands down. Becky gets the job done, you know, and we could go round and round all day long about all the different knives, but those are the most common ones that I generally recommend. And then the last one that I get a lot, it's getting kind of cold out here. The last one that I get a lot, aside from the knives, is flashlights. Recommend me a flashlight. What's your favorite flashlight? That changes a lot. I get so many new flashlights in, and I've never found the perfect flashlight, the one that does everything that I want. I've found a lot of close ones, but in terms of survival, emergency, prepping, capability flashlight, I had them all laid out, and I was thinking about this. I would have to say my favorite flashlight for long-term emergency use is probably the Olight R40 Seeker, which has 1100 lumens. It's got an absurdly huge battery. I think it's something like 4400 mAh, something like that. And it's charged via a micro USB. So you can charge it a lot of different ways. Your phone charger, in your car, off a BioLite stove, off a solar charger, plugging it into the wall, and it's got enough juice that it's going to last a long, long time. It's got a great beam, good reflector, great throw. It's not too big. It's not a pocket EDC light. It's a little big, but not too big. As far as pocketable EDC lights, I would say my number one pick, I've been carrying this for 3 weeks, which I think is some sort of record for me. It's still the S20R from Olight with the magnetic base charger. I talked about that in the recent EDC video. It's just an excellent EDC light. And then for maybe a budget tactical light, what's my favorite? I go back and forth between the Thru-Night T30S V2 and the newer TN11S V2, both of which great functionality, good spacing, great throw, both about $49. So there you go, guys. That is, I wrote it down. I looked through all my notes and stuff like that. I get those questions all the time. So hopefully this will help people, and I'm gonna leave this up on the front of my page once in a while, and I'm gonna keep liking it so it just keeps getting out there. And the more people that see it, when you see that the guy asked that question in a video comment section, you can help me out and answer it for me, because I'm telling you, I get it a lot. I'm 78,000 subscribers, hope to be up in the 90s by the time I get the SHOT Show next month. That many new people coming in at any given moment, the questions just keep coming. So that's why I did this video. So hopefully that helps a lot of you new people out. Anyway, thank you for watching. I'm Chris from Preparedmind101. Be sure to click like, share, and subscribe. Most of the action that isn't taking place on YouTube is taking place on the Preparedmind101 Facebook page, which is now over 10,000 likes. It's facebook.com/preparedmind101. A lot of the secret contests and stuff, that's where they're at. I'm sorry, but that's just, it's just easier to manage them there than there is on YouTube. And when you do giveaways on YouTube, like it or not, you tend to attract a lot of people that are just there for the free stuff. They don't give two craps about your channel, and that just skews your subscriber numbers. And I don't want that. I want people to subscribe because they like the channel, not because they want a free flashlight or something like that. You can also support the channel by shopping at preparemind101.com. That is my Amazon store. If you're overseas, it's not going to be a lot of help for you, but if you're in the US, buying there, it's exactly like shopping at Amazon. It is Amazon. I'm just the doorway to Amazon, and I get a little percentage by going through that door. If you don't see what you're looking for on my store, you just click that button at the top. It says powered by Amazon.com, and poof, it turns into regular Amazon. And then you can buy computers or whatever the heck you want. So it's not costing you anything else. And the reason I did that is because I live on Amazon. Half the stuff that I show on this channel, I bought on Amazon. I've been a Prime member for like 4 years. It's worth it to shop there, just because if you have a problem, it's easy to get it fixed, easy to send things back, so on and so forth. Also follow me on Google+, Instagram, and Twitter. I'll be back with some more videos here soon. They're gonna slow down a little bit here in the last part of December, just because of the holidays and family stuff and all that, but I'm still gonna try and squeeze them in there. January, SHOT Show's coming. I'm gonna be there for the entire week in Vegas. Gonna be a lot more SHOT Show videos than there was last time, a lot more contacts, so hopefully I'll be getting a lot more new interesting products to showcase on Preparedmind101. All right, guys, thanks for watching. See you next time.